Okay. How are you guys doing this morning? Are you guys excited to be here? Is this weather not awesome? There we go. Hey, my name is Pastor Andy. I'm going to give you announcements today, and I have a question for you. Why don't dolphins get in trouble? It's a good guess. Could be. Because they don't do anything on porpoise. It was a tough one. For those out there, I'll take it. Just to work through a couple of announcements, if you're visiting with us this morning for the first time, welcome. We love that you're here. Please know out by the Welcome Center, there is a QR code that you can scan to fill out an information card so we can stay in touch with you. And also grab a coffee mug. We'd love to bless you with a coffee mug. You can also find out things about our church when you scan that QR code, and we would encourage you to do that. A reminder to members of our church, LWF, our second quarter members meeting will be Sunday, June the 20th at 4 p.m. There's been some question about that. It's at 4 p.m. here at the new building. Child care will not be provided. The Father-Son Campout is happening next week, Friday the 11th and Saturday the 12th. Please see the Church Center app to sign up or see Adam Nordiker with any questions you might have that way. Parents of youth, a reminder that the Adventureland trip is coming up on June 12th. If you have any questions about that, you can see Rob Pearson about that. He is not here today, but he would love to answer questions that you have if you run into him that way. Save the date for VBS, July 19th through the 23rd. There's a table out front. Julie, raise your hand. Yep. See Julie if you have any questions. If you need to sign up or would like to sign up to volunteer, there's different ways you can be involved with VBS. We would encourage you to do that. See the sign-up table. Also, if you would just like to donate supplies, you can scan the QR code at the table, and we'll clue you in about how to be involved that way. Finally, we don't pass the plate here. We have offering boxes out front to the side here, and we would encourage you to be a cheerful giver. If some people just want to give online, we would also encourage you to do that at lwf.churchcenter.com/giving. I don't think I have anything else for you. It's great to see you this morning. Are you excited to be here? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, we'll invite Lawrence to go ahead and move on with the word of worship.
Good morning. All right, I'm going to share a quick devotional thought here this morning as we're moving into our time of worship. So the encouragement that I want to share with you guys this morning is that in Christ, Christians are secure. So as believers, we are secure in Christ. I was reading in Romans 8 yesterday, and towards the end of that chapter, Paul lays out a solid case for our security in Christ. So he leads off in verse 28, speaking out against fear, and says, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose." So he's assuring us right away that we can trust that God desires good for us. He leads on in verses 29 and 30 and goes on to say, "For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified." One of the illustrations that I've heard before for those two verses is that each of those things are like a link in a chain, link in an unbreakable chain, and God's holding either end of that chain. So everyone that God foreknew, he predestined. Everyone that he predestined, he called. Everyone that he called, he justified, and everyone he justified will be glorified. And so as we think about the fact that God's holding that chain, if that's the illustration you're thinking of, you know, we can place our faith in the fact that God's sovereign, he's in control of those things, and again, that just goes back to us not needing to worry, not having any reason for fear or despair. Verse 31 says, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" So Paul's encouraging us there that there's no adversary who can stand against us if we're in Christ and God is for us. Verse 32, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things?" So in that, Paul's assuring us that that God's our great provider, and that nothing that we need to accomplish the purposes that he has for us, none of those needs will go unmet. Verse 33, Paul explains that there's no charge against us. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. So Paul's asking, basically, who could possibly successfully accuse someone who's already been declared righteous by God? Nobody's the answer to that. So in the rest of this chapter, he covers two more things. The first thing is that there's no separation. So verse 35, he says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? And he goes on in verse 38, for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, he keeps going through the list, and then he says, nor anything else in all creation. So he takes away anything else you can possibly think of in all of creation and points out that none of those things can separate us from the love of Christ. And then the last thing in verse 37, he shows us that there's no defeat. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. So not just conquerors, more than conquerors, taking away any thought of the possibility of defeat. So in this short passage, Paul shows us that there's no need for fear, no need for despair, no adversary who can stand against us, no unmet needs that we'll have, no charge or accusation that will stand against us, no condemnation, no separation from the love of Christ, and no defeat. So as we move into our time of worship this morning, be encouraged, brothers and sisters, that in Christ we are secure. And with that, we'll open in prayer. All right, Father, thanks so much for today. God, we're thankful for the ways even that you're already at work and at work all the time, God, in the hearts of men and women. We're thankful for what Paul talks about in this passage, that as believers we are secure in Christ. God, we pray that you would prepare our hearts for our time of worship, God, and for the hearing of your word. Pray for Cole as he is about to preach a message, God. Just bless him, give him the words that you've prepared for us, God, and I just pray that you would use those words to renew our minds and to change our hearts, God. Thank you so much for your great love for us, and pray that you would bless the rest of this morning. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's go ahead and stand. If you're in Christ Jesus this morning, aren't you thankful for that we're free from our sins? When there's no little chains like what we talked about there, we're not condemned, we're not separated from our Lord. As soon as our brother gets all hooked up here, we'll start singing this morning. No pressure. All right. You ready, bro? All right. Let's sing. Let's sing loud and proud, okay?
Since the judge is my defense, I'm going free. Right when the gavel fell, I heard the freedom bell ring through the heart of hell. I'm going free, I'm going free. Glory, glory, hallelujah, you threw my shackles in the sea. That's just not who I am, Lord, I'm a brand new man, I'm going free. I'm on a narrow road, it's paved with grace and hope, it's gonna lead me home. I'm going free, I'm going free.
Amen. Sing it.
Glory, glory, hallelujah, you threw my shackles in the sea. I am free indeed. Someday I'll fly away on your amazing grace. Your love is my jailbreak. I'm going free. I'm going free.
Sing it again. Come on.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea.
Let us bless the Lord.
magnify the Lord with me.
Come up.
Come exalt his name together. May fail, my God, you. Let your spirit strong in me. My flesh may fail. My God, you never will.
Amen. Praise the Lord this morning. You may be seated.
Good morning. How are we doing today?
Awesome.
There you go. Too blessed to be depressed. That's good. Hey, go ahead and open your Bibles this morning to Psalm 82. And while you're doing that, we're going to go ahead and have our tech team play our sermon audio for us today. Or I'm sorry, it's not sermon audio. It's scripture reading. There we go. Whatever you want to call it in an Irish accent, go for it.
Psalm 82, a psalm of Asaph. God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Selah. Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have neither knowledge nor understanding. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said, "You are gods, sons of the Most High, all of you. Nevertheless, like men, you shall die and fall like any prince. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for you shall inherit all the nations."
And this is God's word. Let's go ahead and open in a word of prayer. God, thank you for the morning where we can gather on a beautiful day and the breeze is nice. And we open your word, God. We come to hear from you. We don't come to hear from men. Lord, we don't need my voice preaching today. But God, we just pray that you would speak to us through your word, that you would make clear your gospel to us today. In your name, amen. Well, good morning again. For those of you who have not been here previously, this might be your first time. My name is Cole. I am not the normal preaching pastor around here, and you can take the word normal in whatever fashion you want. So, but as far as that goes, Josh, he's on vacation this week and next, and we'll see him back here after that. Pastor Andy will be on next week, so you've got to, you know, we start with the bottom and work our way up to the best. So anyway, but thank you for being here today. As we look at Psalm 82, I want to draw your attention to the psalm, because if you were listening to that reading of the scripture, which, by the way, listening to a sermon with an Irish accent would be great. In fact, so great, the tech team asked me to do it. I can't do an Irish accent. I'm sorry, guys. So you're just going to have to put up with my my American accent. But here we go. So we open up the book of Psalms to 82. It's yet another psalm of Asaph, who is the worship leader in Israel at the time, and I'm not sure in what circumstance he was the worship leader, but he was a worship leader. And he starts out the passage, and as we listened through, you might have heard the word judge and judgment a few times in there, and justice. And how many of you guys, I want to start out with a question, how many of you guys like to be judged? Okay? Everybody's like, no, I don't like to be judged. Who wants to be judged, right? I don't want to be judged. Don't judge me. Don't judge, lest you be judged, right? So we kind of have this idea that judgment is bad, and I'm hoping today we can flip a switch on our perspective of judgment. And I would offer to you today something that you might have never thought of, and that is judgment is good. And some of you are looking at me like, he's crazy. No wonder he's third string, okay? So judgment is good. So since I can see the discomfort in your faces, we're going to practice saying that together. We're going to start getting used to this. Okay, so go ahead, say it with me. Judgment is good. Okay, now what I want you to do next is I want you to look at the neighbor closest to you and go ahead and say, I'm going to be judged. Okay, go ahead and say that. Okay, now it got really uncomfortable. Yeah, see, everyone's like, oh, man. Okay, go ahead and look at your neighbor. This will make you less uncomfortable. Say to your neighbor, you're going to be judged. You're going to be judged. Okay, there we go. So we're talking about judgment today. And we're going to talk about the gospel today because judgment and the gospel are not separate ideas. They're not separate ideas. We love the gospel. We hate judgment. Yet somehow we should love what makes the gospel the gospel. And I want to present that to you today in God's word. So what Asaph does is he starts out and he gives us a word picture. Now, have you ever seen a picture of something that is just incredible? It's amazing. And then when you see it in person, you're like, the picture didn't do it justice, right? You thought it was good on the surface, but when you saw it in person, you're like, that picture isn't even close. I had two experiences like this in my life. One was as a six-year-old boy. My parents, my dad, he had a Ford F-150 regular cab pickup. And back in the day when you could stick four kids in the back of that pickup and drive to Canada, he did that, okay? And so we drove to Canada in the back. It had a topper, people. We weren't going to just fall out, but he was nice. He put a mattress back there. But we still rode from Iowa to Canada and back in the back of a Ford pickup truck, okay? So how many, all the parents are like, your parents are terrible. They are the worst people on earth. Yes, they are. And I hope they hear this sermon audio so they can know how dangerous they were, and it's amazing we lived through childhood. Okay? But we went to Niagara Falls when I was 6 years old. And when I went to Niagara Falls as a six-year-old, I had seen a picture. My parents were like, we're going to go to Niagara Falls. I'm like, why would we do that? Well, check out this picture. Isn't it cool? And I'm like, yeah, it's a cool picture. But why are we doing that? And then we get to Niagara Falls. And as a six-year-old, you're looking up at Niagara Falls, and it's incredible, isn't it? Like, how many of you have ever been to Niagara Falls? Yeah, a few of you. Okay, so you know what I'm talking about. The picture didn't do it justice, did it? When I was 21 years old, I was a missionary intern in Peru, which is the country that my wife and I are going to serve as missionaries, and I had an opportunity in Cusco to go to the ancient ruins of the Incas at Machu Picchu, the grounds. And if you guys have ever seen this, this is one of the seven wonders of the world, okay? And I had seen pictures, and I was like, cool, it's a mountain. It's got little stair steps in it and stuff. Let me tell you something. Those stair steps are not little. They're massive. They're massive. And standing over the ruins, there's a trail up near the top of one side of the mountain that kind of overlooks the ruins, and then there's this mountain up behind it called Huayna Picchu, and it's got this staircase that's like built into the side of it that you can climb up, and it's called the Staircase of Death, by the way, just so you know. So if you're thinking about climbing it, you better be physically fit, but it's massive. And when you see this, you see the ancient structures sitting there. These terraces into the side of the mountain. The stones are massive. They're as tall as this building by like 20 feet wide by 20 feet deep. And you sit there and go, how in the world did ancient people put this here? The stones are cut and almost perfectly fitted. No grout, no mortar. It's incredible. The picture doesn't do it justice, right? So here we are. And Asaph tries to give us a picture of something that doesn't truly do it justice. God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. Think about that for a second. Try to grasp your head around what it would look like your mind's eye, what it would look like to see the God of the universe enter a courtroom presiding over the gods of this world. Now, he uses strong language because he's making a point. Okay, we know from the entirety of Scripture there is how many gods? One God. Okay? We can address that on a different day and discuss the Trinity, but there is one God according to Scripture. So how is he presiding over the gods? Well, theologians have been arguing about this for over 2,000 years, so let me just break it down for you. Three main viewpoints. One is that he is presiding over the false gods and deities of the nations surrounding Israel, okay? I would argue, respectfully, that that would not be true, because we know from the Old Testament, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, Chronicles, we know that those false gods were nothing more than wood and stone and gold and things made by men that meant nothing. And so I would say that was probably the wrong interpretation of gods. The second one is probably more valid than the first, though I'm still not convinced, is that they believe there's some sort of angelic or heavenly influence. Perhaps there was angels over different nations that had wrongly judged, and they were demons. Maybe Satan's in the midst of this. They are referred to as the sons of God, after all, in different passages of Scripture. And so as we get to the end of this passage, towards the end in 6, he calls them sons of the Most High. And so maybe that's a correlation. I would again question that because of God's indictment in verse 2. How long will you judge unjustly? Last I checked, it wasn't the demon's job to judge people. Sure, they led them into all sorts of depravity and wickedness and tormented them, but I don't see anywhere else in Scripture where demons judge people. And I think you'd be in agreement with that. And if you're not, please show me in Scripture where that is. Option 3, which I would lean towards, and for the purpose of our conversation today, is that the gods referred to in verse 1 are humans that have been placed in places of authority in governments, whether presidents or kings, princes, officials, administrators, judges themselves, townships, governors, etc. You name it, from every nation, God walks into a courtroom, and before him sit some people that you might recognize and some people you might not recognize. Maybe President Biden is there, or Xi Jinping from China, which I probably said that wrong because it's a Chinese name and I don't speak Chinese. Emmanuel Macron from France. And you've got all these other rulers across the world from every type of government that you can think of, whether it be a free republic, a communist dictatorship, and everything in between. They're sitting there in the courtroom, not presiding over anyone themselves for the very first time, but they're sitting underneath the judgment of God Almighty as he walks in. And I imagine there would be a sense of terror in that scene as the God of the universe reveals to a group of proud, unjust people his glory. Small picture to a big, big reality. And so he paints that word picture, and then he begins quoting God's indictment to these men. Now, this passage has the indictment, the instruction, which is how they're, so the indictment of their justice and their judging, the type of judging they should be doing, the explanation of the people they're to be judging, and who their position is at present, and then who they're subordinate to, okay? And we're going to work our way through that. So as we get going in this passage, God presides over a divine council. What do you think of that? Does that blow your mind a little bit, trying to wrap your head around the God of the universe who presides over a divine council? And if you think that the God of the universe that presides over the divine council, and the reason it's called the divine council is because he appointed each of those people to deliver and administer justice, and we'll get there later. Do you think he doesn't have the authority and ability to preside over you? Is yet my other question. You see, it would be a terrifying thing. I imagine I'd be somewhere near the back of that courtroom as having very little authority over anyone. I mean, for some, they're like, yeah, Cole's in charge of himself, 4 little kids. You know, he's not in charge of much. Certainly no state or nation. But I would still, in a courtroom like that that's filled with the glory of God, in a judging setting, I think I would probably be a little bit terrified in that moment. And I think if we were to be honest with ourselves, we would be, because our perception of judgment always leads to punishment, does it not? It leads to justice, and justice punishes what is wicked, and it acquits that which is righteous, does it not? It punishes what's wicked and it acquits what's considered righteous or declared right, what is justified. Okay? So let's go ahead and see how God's indictment starts. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Strong words. God starts out with a pop to the face, right? Just boom. in the mouth? How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? He brings to light the fact that there is wickedness happening in the positions that he has placed people. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I've had jobs before. You guys have jobs? Have a job with a boss, right? Anyone have a boss? Okay. I currently have been self-employed for about a decade. My boss is a jerk, okay? I'm just going to throw that out there. He makes me do stuff I don't want to do on days I don't want to do it. It's terrible, okay? And for some of you, you might be like, yeah, but it's not me. It's somebody else that does that. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I relate. But before I was my own boss, I had a boss. And bosses give reviews, don't they? They let you know if you're doing well or if you're not doing well, right? I mean, can we, you know, that's pretty normal standard procedure. So you get your year-end review. Anyone get year-end reviews or used to get year-end reviews if you're retired? Yeah, of course you did. You get year-end reviews, and this is the things you did great. And here's your, you know, how we say it now. These are your areas of improvement. That's code for you stink at that, okay? So in case you didn't know, that's what it is. And God has appointed these rulers to administer justice to his people, and they're doing a terrible job. So bad, in fact, that this skipped the year-end review and went straight for the judgment seat. And so he continues, and he names out four things that we're going to see from verses 2 through 4 that are the jobs of the judges that he had given them that they weren't doing right. So what were the things? He says, give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. So he gives them four action words. These are the things that a good judge should do. Someone who presides over a people. Someone who administers justice to do what is right and to turn away from what's wrong and to punish what is wrong. This is what they're to do. And his indictment statement is, how long will you judge unjustly? He's saying, you're doing a terrible job. And these are the leaders of our world. I bet you've never thought we had a leader in our world that was terrible. Anyone know? If this last year wasn't a tell of where you fell in opinion, you know, some of you were very celebratory of our current president, and some of you were very not celebratory of our current president. Some of you were happy with our governor election a few years back, and some of you were not. And so on and so forth. As we go through all of our elected officials in our cultural context, right, because we're not in a communist dictatorship, we don't just get told, we actually get to throw a vote. But even as we throw a vote, God appoints these people. He appoints these people. And we do see the injustices among our leaders, do we not? We see things that happen that ought not happen. And so what he does is, on number one, he says, give justice to the weak. Now, how many of us love to see justice not be served, right? You just prefer justice not be served. Criminals, just let them go, right? How many of you want your criminals living in your basement? Raise the hands. Nobody, right? You don't want a criminal living in your basement. That's a terrible idea. And so you want justice to be administered. God is deeply concerned with justice, and I think sometimes we get a wrong perspective of the God of the Bible, because many times as believers in Christ, or even as unbelievers, you might feel like there's almost like two different gods in the Bible, right? Because Jesus is God, and God the Father is God, and the God of the Old Testament seemed divinely entranced with this idea of justice, right? And this other God, and Jesus in the New Testament, he's all about grace and mercy and, you know, love and kindness, and some of you would even go as far as sunshine and rainbows and bunnies, right? So what's with the two gods, right? And we know there's one God, and we have a hard time putting these things together in our mind because we love the grace of the New Testament, and we're really not a big fan of all this justice that we talk about, the judging. And that's why I want to bring to light today this idea that judgment is actually good. Because the grace of God and the judgment of God are not contradictory of each other. They're together. They're perfectly unified. God is not divided. So what we need to do is look at the character of God in this. And so one, he says this, give justice to the weak. Now, how many think a good judge, a righteous judge, would give justice to the weak. You think that's a good idea? Yes. Anyone in disagreement? Go away. No, I'm just kidding. Justice being administered is something that we want, right? So one of the four things, we could say that if that was the only one, that judgment is good, right? Because it gives justice to the weak. None of us are opposed to justice for the weak. So how can we say judgment is bad? We would say judgment is good. God's long been concerned about justice, and God not only did that in the Old Testament, but he also exemplified it in the New Testament as he sent his son Jesus to share the good news of how people could be justified. You understand that? Right judgment renders judgment correctly. There's a payment for every penalty. There's a payment for every wickedness. There's a penalty for our sin. And God judges rightly, but instead of being the judge that sits on the bench and has nothing to do with the solution, the God of the universe sends his son Jesus to die for our justification so the payment of the sin could be made. You know, you think that God might be different Old Testament to New Testament, and I'd encourage you to take a look at a couple of things. One, the justice or even social justice of men doesn't count in God's world. In Psalm 28:5, it says, "Evil men do not understand justice, but those who seek the Lord understand it completely." You want to know the difference between a judge or one of these gods, if you will, that is going to administer justice rightly or not administer justice rightly, is this, whether they seek the Lord or not. The Lord makes it no more complicated than that. If your vote in America goes for someone who has no regard for the Lord, don't be surprised when they render no justice. Don't be surprised, because God makes it clear they don't even know how. They don't know how, because they don't understand justice. But those who seek the Lord understand it completely. And if you think the God of the Old Testament is different than Jesus Christ, I'd like to correct your thinking in Hebrews 1:3. Jesus, where Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews writes, Jesus is the exact imprint of the Father. Think about that. He is the exact imprint. If God is concerned with justice, Jesus, the justifier, was also concerned with justice. Number two on your list there is his job to guard the rights of the afflicted. So a good judge guards rights of the afflicted. It might say in verse 3 halfway through, maintain the right. That means to guard. That's what that word means. And someone who guards, they are to do what? They're to place themselves between the target, if you will, or the oppressed, and the one doling out the torment. Any of you guys ever see the movie, what is it called? Air Force One. Thank you, Brandon. He was here in the first sermon. I didn't forget it then. Air Force One. Ever see that movie? You know, Harrison Ford is on a plane. How did his Secret Service do? They kind of all died, right? But they protected the president, did they not? He got away, and then he himself administered justice because he's Harrison Ford, a.k.a. Indiana Jones, right? So, I mean, he went all indie on these terrorists. It was wonderful, right? It was made for a great movie. Okay, what's the point? His bodyguard did their job at the cost of their own life. A good judge will do likewise. The judge is the one who guards, not in the physical sense, but by administering the law and justice correctly, will guard and maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Now, how many of you think it's a bad thing to guard or to maintain the right of the weak and the destitute? It's not. And so I would submit to you on point number two, judgment is good. Judgment is good when it's done correctly. Number three, what's the job of a judge? To rescue the weak and the needy. Again, this should point us straight to Jesus, but we'll take a look at this context here. As they rescue the weak and the needy, for one, I don't think any of us would say that's a bad thing as well. But beyond that, as we point to Jesus, in Galatians 1, 3 through 5, talks about Jesus who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from this present age. You see, the job of a judge needs to be administering justice in such a fashion that it rescues the person that has no power to rescue themselves. I think we can all agree that would be a pretty good thing, right? So judgment is yet again found to be good because it's intended for our deliverance, deliverance of the oppressed, the weak, the needy. It's intended to save. Jesus came not to heal those who had no need, but to heal the sick. He came for those who were in need of deliverance, not only from their physical infirmities at the time, but of their spiritual infirmity of death and judgment. So, question for you today, is judgment a bad thing? Class? No, it's not. Judgment's not a bad thing. Judgment, when it's used properly, is intended for deliverance. Many times in our Christian walk, we judge others, don't we? But do we judge rightly is the question. I think the reason we think judgment is so bad, in part, is because we are not good judges ourselves. Are we? We very much take one perspective. We don't hear all sides, right? Scripture talks about this. The one who speaks first seems right until another comes against them. Proverbs. But we as humans, what do we want to do? Well, my friend said this, so it must be true because it's my friend, right? Because my friend is not a sinful human being. They couldn't be because they're my friend, right? It shows partiality. Partiality. What was God's indictment? How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Do you know that sometimes showing partiality to your own friends and family is showing partiality to the wicked? Did you know that? Did you know you're friends with wicked people? If you don't believe it, go look yourself in the mirror. Do you like you? Some days yes, and some days no. But we take pretty good care of ourselves, don't we? Nobody pulled me out of bed this morning. Nobody put me in the shower and washed me. No one brushed my teeth. No one combed my hair. No one put clothes on me. No one's put deodorant on me. I did all of that, and aren't you blessed? Whew! Man, praise the Lord, Cole, for not stinking, right? I take pretty good care of myself, but if I look in the mirror and look in myself in the eye and think clearly about who I am before a holy God, I am also wicked. God, in his just judgment, shows no partiality to the wicked. None. So just because Cole Albright wants something done a certain way doesn't mean he's going to get his way if it's not the right way in God's just world. And do we live in God's just world? No, we live in a very unjust world, one that's marred with sin and torment and interpersonal problems, political strife, unrest, racial tensions. It's crazy. We live in a crazy world, don't we? And yet we are so quick to say, yes, God, judge the gods, right? Because we see these political folks and these world rulers and these judges and these township authorities and the stinking inspectors of the city of Des Moines, Josh Raleigh. Gosh, and we see them as unjust. Yet if we look in the mirror, we're no different. We're no different. And so he guards our rights, and he's there to rescue. That's the last thing the judge does. He rescues the weak and the needy, which also points us straight to Jesus Christ. He gave himself for our sins to rescue us from this present evil age. Galatians 1:3. Did you know that? You see, the God of the universe was so concerned with justice being done correctly, that he judged rightly, and in his judgment he found that there was no one that could deliver people aside from himself. No one. And so he sends his son, Jesus Christ, who is God, to be what? To be the deliverer. And he delivered in what way? He gave himself, his own life, for our sins. For what purpose? To rescue us from this present evil age. God indicts the gods of this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the indictment. They couldn't measure up. Have you ever considered that? So the gospel of Jesus and the grace of God, which we love, is in perfect harmony with his judgment, which makes his judgment so good. So, is judgment good? So here's the question. If judgment isn't good, or if you're still uneasy about that, here's the question. Which side of the judgment will you fall? Which side of the judgment of God will you fall? Will you fall under the judgment of God that casts you away? Or will you fall under the justification of God, which is found in Jesus Christ? That's the question. Because whether or not judgment is good in your mind is entirely up to which side of that coin you're on. So let's talk about that, because God goes on in verse, well, let's start with 5. He says they have, so he talks about the status of us as not the authorities that he placed, but as people being governed by the authority he placed. Now, if you're in a place of governance, then this is a trickle-down effect, but you're ultimately, unless you lead a nation, or even the world for that matter, you fall underneath a governance of some sort. Excuse me. And so he says to those that are under a governance of some sort, they have neither knowledge or understanding. Now, wait a minute, God, are you calling us stupid? Kinda. A little ignorant. They have neither knowledge or understanding. They walk about in darkness. That word darkness signifies intellectual ignorance and moral depravity, right? Because when you're not intellectually aware of God's standard or flippantly not concerned, it leads to depravity. We walk about in darkness. We can't see. Jesus talked about it this way. He said, though seeing, they do not perceive. In hearing, they don't understand. You see, Jesus was well aware that he could speak the very words of God because he was God, is God, not just was, but he is God. He could speak words, people could hear him with their ears and not even have a clue because the Spirit had not revealed it to them. And then he goes on after saying they walk about in darkness, all the foundations of the earth are shaken. MacArthur put it this way. He said, when leaders rule unjustly, and this has to do with the foundation of the earth being shaken, right? Like, we all know that the world is round and it's held in the, you know, in space by gravity, and the Bible says it's by the power of his might that he holds all things together, okay? So where is this foundation? Well, the foundation is in God himself. And MacArthur said it this way, when leaders rule unjustly, the divinely established moral order that undergirds human existence is undermined. I'm going to read that for you one more time. Try to wrap your head around it. He's a super smart guy. I didn't write that. He says, when leaders rule unjustly, the divinely established moral order that undergirds human existence is undermined. What he's saying is that God established an order, and when we ignore that order in depravity, the entirety of our human existence is undermined. Is it a wonder that sin is rampant everywhere you go? Is it not? It's everywhere. And so God continues his indictment, and he says to them directly, I said, you are gods, sons of the Most High, all of you. Nevertheless, like men, you shall die and fall like any prince. You see, God has the power to lift up leaders, and I want to share that with you a little bit, and he has the ability to put them down. I think many times we think we're victims of, you know, whatever leader is in place at the time. God placed them there. Did you know that? He placed them there. I want to flip over to Romans chapter 13 real quick. Sorry for the coughing today, guys. I've got a dust allergy. You can't catch it, I don't think. So if you can, that's interesting. So, oh, boy. Romans 13. He says this, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God." What? You mean God put in place the governing authorities? Yes, he did. Did you know that you might have had a vote in this last election, but God established the leader? He picked the guy. No, God wouldn't pick that guy. God picked the last guy. Or maybe you're the other side. You're like, no, God did not pick the last guy. God picked both. Did you know that? God picked both because he is the one that establishes authority, whether we agree with his decision or not. And he's the one that judges those authorities based on the way that they govern. We don't actually have the authority to judge them. We're called to pray for them. What? I'm supposed to pray for Joe and for President Trump or ex-President Trump? Yeah, you're supposed to pray for both of them. He says this, "Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed." Oh, okay, so when you're resisting your authorities and slandering your authorities, guess what that means? That means you're resisting God and slandering the person he placed in authority. Those who resist will incur judgment. There's that word again. Oh, that's not exciting. Okay, judgment got bad again. No, it didn't. He says this, "For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what's good, and you'll receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good." Have you ever thought of that? President Trump, President Biden, they're God's servant for your good. And the God of the universe put them in their place, regardless of your vote or your opinion of them. Did you know God doesn't need our, he doesn't need our opinion to pick leaders? I know, that's very un-American of me to say. So don't worry, I'll be leaving the country soon. You don't have to put up with it too long, okay? Because God has the authority that none of us have. "Nevertheless, like men, you shall die and fall like any prince." God has the eternal extension cord, really. My kids, have you ever had your kids take a radio, plug it in, and turn it up to like 1,000? And you're so annoyed with it, you don't even go for the volume button. You just go yank the cord right out of the wall. You ever done that? I had to do it with a plumber this week, which was kind of like dealing with a child. I had a plumber over to my house working on something. Apparently, he thought that it was time to play, you know, his music. I won't even tell you what it was. But I was like, my kids don't need to hear Fat Bottom Girls. They just don't, okay? So we're going to go ahead. And I unplugged his radio. I was like, what are you doing? This is my house. Stop that. I have the authority in my house because my house, I can unplug his radio. God has the authority over the rulers of this world because he holds their very lives in his hands, just like he holds yours. And it is nothing for him to make a decision to end that. And he doesn't do it flippantly. He's not a mean, unjust God. But he is a God that judges rightly, with or without your permission, believer in Christ. So the question is, which side of the judgment do you fall? You can see where Asaph falls. Verse 8, "Arise, O God, judge the earth." How many of you guys would be exclaiming that on your way into church? Man, I hope God just judges the earth today. That'd be awesome, right? How many of you are like walking in and be like, I'm ready to hear a sermon about God judging the earth, and I'm going to be excited about it. Outside of, I believe you, Nate. Nate's like, yep, that's me. I'm like, and I believe him. I wouldn't believe the rest of you, but I would definitely believe Nate. And you don't consider those things. I don't consider those things. But he exclaims in worship, "Arise, O God, judge the earth, for you shall inherit all nations. You see, part of God's judgment is God's inheritance, and his inheritance is not necessarily the earth, as he states, but it is the people of the earth. God desires to inherit the people of the earth. He desires to have them as his own. But God didn't make robots, did he? He made people. He made people in his image with free will to choose him or to not choose him, to submit to him or to reject him of their own free will. And yet he is a good God that judges rightly despite it. And the question of whether or not judgment is good has entirely to do with which side of the judgment you'll be on. Will you be on the side where you've submitted to his son Jesus Christ, who came, lived a perfect life that we could never live, died an awful death that was the propitiation for our sin. That word propitiation means wrath-removing sacrifice. So that we could be justified on that day. We don't go into the courtroom like these world leaders who judged unrightly and God is judging them. We walk in with Jesus Christ and he says, I see your son, you are, or my son, you are pardoned. I see my son, you are pardoned. For those who have accepted Christ as their Savior, who has recognized himself as a sinner before a holy God with no ability to escape the wrath that was coming outside of trusting his justification. If you're on the opposite side of that, woe to you. I was just reading in Isaiah this morning. It said, woe to those who prefer justice and oppress the weak. God desires to save each of us from the wicked. This world is a wicked place. We ourselves are wicked people. I'm a wicked person. And outside of the grace of God, we have nothing. We will come and die and fall like any prince. Like any prince. How many kings of the world have ever escaped death in years past? Zero. Scripture says in Hebrews 9:27, for it is appointed once for man to die, and then the judgment. I won't make you look at your neighbor and say it this time, but did you know you're going to die? It's going to happen. It's appointed once for man to die, and then the judgment. And so the question is, where do you stand with God? That's it. Where do you stand with God? Have you chosen, have you seen Jesus for who he is, the justifier of your wickedness, and accepted his free gift of salvation? Have you repented of your sins and trusted Jesus to save you? If you have, then you would, with Asaph, say, arise, O Lord, judge the earth, for the nations are your inheritance. John said it this way at the end of Scripture in Revelation. Sorry, I got to flip there and read it. In Revelation 22:20, he who testifies to these things says, surely I'm coming soon. That's Jesus talking. Surely I'm coming soon, amen. And John replies, amen, come, Lord Jesus. You know, it's not surprising that when God rises in judgment, his people are excited to see him because he's a good judge. And judgment is good, especially for those who know him. And so my question is, do you know him? And if you don't, I would encourage you today to repent of your sin, to recognize that outside of the hope that God gives us, we are hopeless on the day of judgment. But God, he sent Jesus to save us. Let's close in a word of prayer. Father God, we are under the reality that judgment is bad for wicked people. And we, Lord, are wicked people, which is why judgment has always been bad. But for those of us who know you, judgment is so good because we don't stand on our own. Lord, you judge the gods of this world, but the gospel is above the gods of this world. The gospel is above us. The gospel is in perfect unity with your judgment. And so, Lord, may we, in confidence, say with John and say with Asaph, arise, O Lord, judge the earth, because we are your inheritance. May that be true today in everyone's life, in this area. In your name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand once more. Are you thankful for Christ's righteousness this morning?
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside.
Yeah. thank you for being here this morning. And just as we close, thank you, Cole, for preaching God's word to us. Amen. There is a passage I was meditating on this morning. Everybody knows Romans 3:23, right? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Most of us just know that verse. We don't read right past it, which sums up exactly what Cole was preaching about this morning. It says in verse 24, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. And it was to say that he sent his son to pay the penalty for our sins so that he didn't just forgive us our sins and become an unjust judge. He is a just judge because he punished Jesus Christ for our sins. And we can rejoice in that judgment. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Thank you guys so much for being here this morning. We love you guys, and we will hopefully see you next week. You're dismissed.